just wanted to wish a very warm welcome to you all on behalf of the Serbian City Club. It is my absolute pleasure that our guest tonight is Stevan Filipović, an award-winning film director, playwright, screenwriter, editor, professor. I would call him an all-around creative ball of energy. Before I properly introduce Stevan, just wanted to let you know that you can send us your questions during the discussion via Zoom chat, and we hope to be able to address them all. Stevan's biography is quite impressive already. For those of you that may not be aware, Stevan's most recent Star Wars inspired short movie called The Breaking Point was screened at the festival in the French town of Menton, and it was nominated in as many as 7 categories and won a special jury award for a short movie. So many congratulations.
Thank you.
I first heard of and met Stevan in 2006. When his first feature, Shaitan's Warrior, Shaitanu Vratnik, was released. The movie was premiered in the UK at the Raindance Film Festival and was described as a comedy horror. And I would also add it had a great dose of mythology. At the time, it was hailed as a breath of fresh air by both critics and the cinema goers, and was aptly named a Serbian Harry Potter. It received many awards, including awards for spectacular special effects that led the way to The Hobbit, but more of it a little bit later. Stevan's next movie, Skinning, Šišanje, was released in 2010, a gripping political drama about extreme right-wing hooligans in Serbia, and in my view a great description and depiction of consequences of making certain life choices and decisions. It won major awards. It was the biggest domestic box office hit this year. It was screened at more than 20 international festivals and also at the British Parliament and the Oxford University. Stevan's third movie was Next to Me, Poredmene, and was released in 2015. And it took an inspiration from The Breakfast Club, a movie I know Stevan loves. And I think it is a great movie as well. And it's a great portrayal of the new generation and their life influences following troubled 90s. It also made an audience stop and reflect on life without social media and other distractions. And again, in the UK, we were extremely lucky to have had the chance to see it at the British Parliament and at the Cambridge University. It was also made into a successful musical and the series. And there are many, many other achievements that I could list here, but that would take too much time. So I would really like to spend more time getting to know Stevan and hearing his views on various topics that some of you have already shared with us, which we have included into the questions that we have shaped. Stevan, welcome. You have been involved in many other projects in the creative industry in Serbia and abroad, and we will mention a few very important ones shortly, but I first wanted to ask you about your reflections on the movie industry in Serbia from the moment you got involved to today. What for you are the main differences or challenges that you can identify?
Well, first, thank you. Nice to see you all. And I'm glad to be here and speak to the people from Serbian City Club and everybody else who is listening. Just to answering your question, I think industry in Serbia, when we speak of the films, is a pretty big word. So I think when we say film industry, we think about commercial film industry, films that can make money and then producers can invest in another films. The model, financial model of filming in Serbia is state funding as in many smaller European countries. So most of the cinematography relies on these state funds. And the problem with state funds and European funds is it gets political in countries like Serbia. So if you don't get local funds, then you cannot go next level and get apply for European funds. And that's a kind of a soft censorship that we have been living in for a long time now. And there is no good way around it. So we're trying to find new ways to make films. And now with the COVID thing happening, we try to think of how to make a film without a budget. How can we use this situation to produce a film that could actually work? We didn't think about the distribution just yet, but with this new film, which is actually a sequel of a feature that you mentioned next to me, this one is called Next to Us, and it's Next to You, sorry. And it's happening 5 years after the first film. So this is a kind of experimental way of how actually we keep on running when the cinemas are not open, when the festivals are mostly not happening or are happening online. So it's been a mixed bag so far. You know, some productions continued filming, then stopped when the statistics went crazy with the COVID casualties and infected the people and so on, and then resumed filming again, now to stop filming again. So basically it's been very similar to the situation that the whole film industry in the wide world is facing in that regard.
And just picking up on that a little bit more, what does that actually mean for the country, even the region now, where cinemas are almost extinct? And I'm using my words quite carefully here. It seems to me that more money is available in kind of areas of entertainment industry that are not encouraging free and thought-provoking thinking, but rather mass entertainment and easy money by playing a fool, so to speak. So how does that, together with Corona and all other issues that you are kind of facing, how detrimental is that for the movie or entertainment industry as such in Serbia and the region?
Well, we face that difficult perspective with a zero chance getting any other funds for films that are political or provocative or different if we don't get the local money first. So that's the kind of a soft censorship that I was talking about. And it's not COVID related, you know, it was happening before and it will continue to happen again. This is a peculiar situation, and when we speak about cinemas in Serbia, actually cinemas were starting to do much better in the recent years. The infrastructure has gotten much better and people were going to see the films, and most of these films are American mainstream box office hits. Just as the cinemas were starting to make money and open their doors for local films to do well with audiences, COVID happened and the shutdown happened. And now we have reopened the cinemas, but very few people actually go there, unlike the restaurants and the cafes, it seems.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting because the coronavirus had quite a significant impact on the theatres and the cinemas in the UK, with some quite disturbing news of Cineworld closing, and it's a very uncertain future for quite a few of these industries. Though, as you have mentioned, in Serbia, it looks like things are functioning to certain extent. And how does it look making a movie as you have during the pandemic? And what do you think will be actually the long-term consequences of this? Because we're currently concentrating on what is currently happening, but actually how do you see this influencing the industry in the next 5 or 10 years, or even in a shorter period?
Well, it's very hard to foresee that, because we don't know how long is this situation going to last. And when it ends, there we have to devise a strategy. When I say we, I mean the everybody working in film, in the whole world. We have to think of a way to bring people back to the cinemas. I love cinemas. I love the experience of watching a movie in a theater. I think it in cinema. I think it's a social event, and it's an important way of socializing and just watching the film and talking about it and connecting with other people. I don't think home entertainment can replace that experience, and especially with the short attention span that we now have with social media and mobile phones and everything. You know, in cinema you have to sort of a switch off and surrender yourself to this work of art for 1 hour, 2 hours, and so on. So I think the most important issue will be, how do we get audiences back to the cinemas? Because as I said, worldwide and in Serbia alike, cinemas were doing quite well in the recent years before the pandemic. So, but you know, things change and habits change, and people get used to seeing really, really good quality TV series at home, and they go to the cinema and see maybe two or three not really great movies, and they say, okay, now the TV is the thing. I'll stay home, I'll play video games or watch some brilliant HBO TV series. So that's the question. We need to have provide content that's appealing to be screened in cinemas, and not just spectacular content. I mean every kind of a film, you know, independent films, European films. We have a very low number of the cinemas that are screening independent and European films, and that's mostly concentrated on film festivals like Fest or something like that. So you can see that year's production and the Oscar nominated film or films that won awards in French or whatever, Italian film festivals, German. So that's the thing that all of us have to work with. But the problems with art house films, that they're usually are very disconnected from the audiences. They don't communicate with mass audiences. I think my career has been built on bridging those two. So I love fantasy cinema. I love films that work in cinemas with audiences, but I also love to pick political subjects and topics to deal with in my films. So I think the combination of the two is really possible. We can bring high quality movies into theaters and make them alive, make them communicate with the modern audiences, and not cut ourselves away from that and entirely depend on those funds, because then it's not about the art, and it becomes about finances and about how to create the best pitch for, I don't know, European co-production, and usually we end up with movies that are subpar, that are not really well and not remembered, and they just get made so people can get paid. So I don't think that's a good model, and I don't think that opens any doors to the possibility of the cinemas surviving this epidemic or some another catastrophe alike.
And just staying on that point, and I promise we will move to more interesting things about your career, but just in terms of what you've said in an answer to the first question, and thinking how Corona has kind of influenced certain things, it is just one of many things that can impact the industry itself. And in a way, you have also said it feels like it's a golden age for TV, not necessarily for movie going. But Corona itself has triggered many important debates in the UK, for example, especially about the subventions that you mentioned, that the government is giving or not giving to the industry and individuals in particular. How does that work in Serbia in general, and especially now during the pandemic? And if you could kind of compare to when you started out to today, have things changed to better or not? Are they the same? How does it feel from your perspective?
Well, I'm the wrong person to talk about that, because I think as it comes to the state funds, I have always been sort of a pariah to them. So I make a movie, and a lot of us work either for free, or we wait the distribution to maybe get paid or something like that. And when I make a successful film, then they, you know, pat me on the back and say, this is amazing, and I get all the awards, and a lot of people watch it in cinemas and so on. But then when I apply with the next screenplay, for example, when Shaitan finished the distribution and went to New Zealand, and everything happened with that good stuff that happened with that film, and it was a box office hit in Serbia and a critical success. For the next film, I didn't get the funds. So we again had to do it, you know, to find a way by hook or by crook to make this film happen. And then when it happened, we got some minimal support that they're obliged to give us. And then for the third film, it was all the same. And now for the fourth film that I'm doing, we went to it without any budget from the state. And well, I'm not going to lie to you, it's not very easy, you know, because the idea of getting to be a good artist is you need to have continuity, you need to work on yourself and to grow as a human being and as an artist. And if you don't and if you do that job and you're not paid for that, and you cannot set up an infrastructure for a lot of good people to have that continuity, all of the associates who work with you, then you get into a problem. That's why I'm skeptical about using the word industry in the context of film in Serbia. Yes, it is an industry, but for people who are connected with government on some level and who can actually get that kind of continuity of these state funds. Mm-hmm. So just the process of deciding has been, let's we say, arbitrary at least in these film funds and the decisions they make. And there we have been fighting. When I say we, just a couple of people actually, namely my producer Branislav Jević and a few of friends and associates, we have been fighting to make it a little bit more transparent, you know, the whole process, a little bit merit-based, and to introduce a bit more quantifiable elements into decisions that these film funds make. But it's an uphill battle, which we will continue to fight.
Yeah, great. And from what you're saying, in a way, it seems to me that people sometimes have a very idealistic view of what movie making industry or movie making is. You know, they'll see red carpets, interviews on TV and print media, you know, they'll go, oh gosh, you know, this person is now famous or a celebrity. Or we'll have a complete opposite and very dim view, hearing that actually there are no funds to make movies, you're not being encouraged, cinemas are empty, and nepotism as a barrier in a way to make it in the industry, which is quite prominent in Serbia, as you have just explained as well. But for somebody starting out now as a kind of young, enthusiastic person who would be inspired to go into the industry, what kind of encouragement would you give them and advice when starting out?
But listen, it's the best job in the world, on the other hand. it's all worth it if you can make it. It's not easy to do that and to give birth to a film, because it includes a labor of hundreds of talented people. Usually when we talk about films, we talk about directors and we talk about actors, but that's not a true picture. There is a great number of extremely talented and dedicated people who are giving everything they can to make a really great film. So that's the thing. We love what we do and we enjoy it very much, you know, no matter how hard it gets. And for young people, I think there has never been a better time in terms of technology to get into films. You know, when I was starting in the early 2000s, we couldn't get a camera to make a film on. You had to pay a lot of money. I had actually to go to London to buy one. Now you can do it on a cell phone. The Steven Soderbergh made two films on iPhone 7, and there has been a number of films in the meantime that are really good narrative feature films made with iPhones. So the technology has never been more available. It's just you need to have a story to tell, and you need to know a way to tell that story. So if money is a problem, then try to bypass that problem and run on the fuel called enthusiasm. And it is possible. You need to have something to cover your basic living expenses, but it is possible just to go jump and swim. So that would be my advice to anybody who is young and willing to go into filmmaking.
Great. And I mean, looking at the kind of movies that you made and the projects that you've been involved in, it's very clear that you're somebody who is not shying away from dabbing into challenging topics and making audiences think by showing a different side to the topics that could be that might be frowned upon or just dismissed. I mean, in your last two movies in particular, they were labeled quite controversial and daring for showing, as described, taboo or sensitive subjects. And I'm specifically thinking of what was portrayed as the first openly gay kiss in a movie, but also the nasty side of hooliganism that you portrayed. And I'm wondering whether you have done so because you actually believe the audience is ready to tackle these subjects, even if the country and there is a popular mass opinion is not? And how do you think that avoiding tackling sensitive subjects and that type of self-imposed censorship in the movie making in Serbia is affecting this particular art form?
I think that's the worst thing that can happen to an artist. You know, self-censorship is really bad. And for me, I agree with Bertolt Brecht, and I recently heard Lily Wachowski quoting him about all art being political. So I'm political and you're political, and everything we say or do and everything we don't do is also some kind of a political message or communication. It is whether we are able or willing to acknowledge it, that's the matter. And a lot of colleagues are just not willing to acknowledge the fact, you know, that they are making political statements when they do make a film that's completely cut off from the reality, from the world they live in. I'm just talking about the subjects that are close to my heart or my mind, and I'm trying to be honest in the things I do. So I think that's the job of every artist. That should be the job of every artist. You know, we are not entertainers. We are here to communicate. You know, and whether audiences find this subject or that subject provocative, or what do you say, taboo, or, you know, that's up to them. You know, I deliver that and then hope for some sort of meaningful conversation.
Did you personally and your colleagues face any type of a backlash in Serbia? Because, I mean, we read it in the news in a way, but how has that affected you as well with the I'm not thinking just necessarily that it was in terms of the criticism, but just the messages that it came out and how the society reacted to them.
Mm.
How has that influenced your movie making onwards?
Well, you know, criticism is always appreciated, but threats are not. We had the problems with my second film, Skinning, and on the premiere we had death threats and we had 60 police people protecting the premiere and so on and so on. And then I thought somebody said, okay, that was brave of you to do that. And I'm thinking, well, I'm making a fiction film. You know, I don't think that's so brave as, for example, investigative journalism in Serbia today, what Brankica Stanković is doing with Insider and so on. So it's just a matter of perspective, I think. I don't think artists should let fear cloud their judgment. You know, we need to keep on doing what we feel and what we think is important, and just not to react in fear and aggression to these threats. But if they get serious, yeah, you have to do something about it, you know, especially if you're dealing with art that is exhibited in public places as motion pictures are.
And do you think that fear, in a way, and the consequences of what's happening to other people, and recently we have seen the actual vandalism with the exhibitions in Zemun and a few other exhibitions which were deemed daring or controversial, that actually puts a strain on people in deciding not to dabble into these kind of topics that are actually very important to discuss. We're, you know, making the movie for the sake of being controversial. I like movies that make me think about the subject matter, but it seems that we are moving away, and I'm not thinking necessarily just in Serbia, it's in around the world as well, that sometimes these kind of topics become lost in translation. But specifically for Serbia, I'm thinking that maybe if people see that you go through all these challenges, that they say, well, actually, maybe I'll just step away and not create any waves, because I want to sustain myself in this job.
Yeah, that's the actually the gist of the problem, because a lot of people are self-censoring for local purposes, just because they want not to get too political and not to deal with touchy subjects, so they can get money from the funds. And then there is also the bigger problem with European co-productions is that kind of colonial perspective, where a lot of decision makers in the European film funds actually are rewarding films that are bland, that are postcards, you know, very simple sort of, if you want Serbia, okay, then you have a social drama about a man who is doing nothing for 2.5 hours, and that's like the kind of a film that they want to see. And I think there are traces of this colonial perspective. You know, you're not getting to play in the major league. You just stay in your place, you know. And a lot of filmmakers from countries like Serbia are susceptible to that. They want to do those kind of films and just to get those funds and make these simple, watered down features that actually run far away from anything that's specific local. So I was thinking about the brilliant films of Živko Nikolić, who made such wonderful comedies about Montenegro and their people from their customs and people from the villages. And he was always loving and understandable about his characters. And he had a deep, deep connection with the people that he was making even sometimes fun of, but that kind of a film that's completely honest and burdened with those local internal jokes that nobody else would understand and that they don't translate well, that they're not simple, they would never work in today's European fun reality, you know. So that's the one of the bigger problems that my generation, I think, has to deal with, just to break this wall and try to communicate and do things in the same league, should I say.
Now I want to move slightly the direction of questions and discuss your creativeness and the opportunities that you were given and took, actually, which I think are really, really inspired. I mentioned Hobbit earlier on, and I think it would be really interesting for all of us today to hear your story of ending up meeting and actually working with Sir Richard Taylor, multiple Oscar winner for visual effects, costumes and makeup on movies such as Lord of the Rings, Avatar and King Kong, and you have you ended up on the set of The Hobbit for about a month. How did it happen, and what were your impressions afterwards?
Well, it was a kind of a dream coming true, because as we were growing up and the digital revolution was starting to happen, we didn't have a lot of literature, we didn't have a lot of sources where we could actually learn all the new stuff that was happening. And one of the biggest moments in cinema in those years was Lord of the Rings by Peter Jackson. And we actually, I call it my second university. They did a brilliant making of features about the production of Lord of the Rings. And they didn't do the classical Hollywood, oh, it was great and we loved each other and so on, but they really delved into the problems that filmmakers face, and they were very honest about it. And it was a very important experience in terms of education. When we did Shaitan's Warrior, and when the opportunity presented itself to meet with Sir Richard Taylor, who was our inspiration to get into the film business or whatever, art, whatever we want to call it, in the first place, that was a real dream come true. And we actually sent the trailer to them, and they loved the trailer. And because that crew, the Weta workshop crew and Peter Jackson, started off in a very small way from a small country that the only connection with the Hollywood market was the common language. But it was very hard for them to make the breakthrough and to get to a project of that size and scale as Lord of the Rings. So I think maybe they recognized something similar in what we did, and they really embraced us. And we had a premiere of Skinning, actually before Belgrade, we had a premiere in Peter Jackson's cinema in Park Road Studios, and a wonderful Q&A with people crying and understanding the film in a way I couldn't anticipate, because I thought the film would be very European, you know, with the dealing with problems that are not so universal, but it appears that I was wrong, and they enjoyed it very much. And then a few years after, I think maybe 1 year after that, I was invited to be on the set of The Hobbit for 1 month as guest of Sir Richard Taylor and Weta Workshop, and that was a really, really fantastic experience to see actually how much of the problems we share. You know, they have a huge budget, like $1 billion for three films, and then everything that goes along with it, 2,000 people crew. But when you distill it, when you go to the basic stuff that we all do and what is the our craft and our art, we in the end face very similar problems. And that was actually a very encouraging thought. That was a very encouraging experience to have. So I'm very grateful for that opportunity.
I'll take one of the questions that we've just received as well. In the last couple of years, many famous production houses from around the world have been filming in Serbia and Belgrade. Quite a few famous artists like Pierce Brosnan for November Man, 3 Days to Kill with Kevin Costner and others. Do you think that Serbia has become more popular destination for Hollywood, and why is that? And how can that benefit Serbian artists?
Ray Fiennes did also two films in Serbia, and the good thing is that after Fiennes' films, we got finally those grants for tax refunds from the state for international co-productions that are, say, more expensive than, I don't know, 100,000 euros or something like that. So they're just choosing the countries where they can, I'm talking about Hollywood productions and European, other European productions. They're choosing countries where they can get a good film crew that is cost effective and that where they can find a lot of interesting locations. So, but I don't think our selling point should be that we're cheaper than Bulgaria. You know, I think we have a lot more to offer. These particular projects are always a point of connection with people from the industry, and they come here and find somebody they like, somebody to work with, if they're not completely closed, if we're just doing the service, if they're the only reason they're choosing Serbia is that it's the lowest cost, then we don't get much of it. Just some of the people who work in the industry get jobs for the duration of that production, which is not bad. It's a good thing for film professionals in Serbia. The byproduct of that is that independent films can't match the salaries, and that's one of the problems I faced for the first time now. You know, you have people that are doing the lighting, the makeup, and costumes, sets, and so on, and they're actually used to these salaries that are maybe not big for Hollywood, but for Serbian standards are really good. And then when you're doing an independent film, you can't match that. I think we should concentrate on finding something that's a solution for both things. It's good to have Hollywood productions in Serbia and to draw a lot of other countries if they want to make films here and to offer very good services. It's what J.K. Rowling did with Harry Potter. She insisted that the films were made in Britain and by British crew. I think that's very, I don't use the word patriotic much. I can think it's been used and abused in a lot of instances, but that was a patriotic thing to do, and it revived the British film industry. I think it gave a lot of people jobs and put them right on the map again with Hollywood, and especially special effects houses and so on, not to mention actors and everything. So I think we need to keep that and to find a way how can we use some of that money to actually fund independent film productions in Serbian cinematography that is not purely commercial.
Yeah, and just as a follow-up that's just arrived, which I think fits really well with what you were just saying in terms of the local talent as well. How and where are you finding young actors for your films? Because quite a few of them have been unknowns, so to speak, before they were featured in your movies. So what is your process as well?
Well, you know, I have been very lucky with this last film, Next to Me. I was working as a professor at University of Art, Academy of Arts in Belgrade. I was actually a professor to these students, and a lot of them came from there. And for the other roles, I think castings are very important. I think when you go as a director and watch a play, that's sort of a casting process. You know, you find someone and you remember somebody, and maybe if you don't call them to be in your next film, you'll call them to be in your second next film. So I think for young people who are starting to work as actors, I think the finding ways to participate in student films, generational films, and a lot of projects that depend on enthusiasm is actually the key. Because, you know, if I had a great experience with somebody when I was doing that for no budget, of course, I will try to call them when I'm doing another project and I have a budget. Usually, you know, people try to think like that. But I think we need to have more castings, we as directors, as producers. And the best advice to young people is to just go and work. And if you can't find work, then invent it. Think of your own thing, you know, invent a monodrama that you can do with limited resources, find people who are interested in that, and try to do quality things that are really close to your heart, you know, because it's not work, it's a passion, it's a artistic expression that has to be connected with what drives you. And if you put that passion somewhere, it will be noticed, that almost certainly it will be noticed, you know, but you have to really get out of the comfort zone and risk and be rejected, actually be rejected 99% of the time. Me too, similar process for directors, you know, and just get used to it and try to build something. If you're not given the opportunity to make, then make it.
And talking about collaborations that kind of start with no budgets, your collaboration with people outside of Serbia is now, I think, becoming quite legendary. And I want to bring us now to the project that you mentioned early on as well, that you're involved in, and that is related to the Next to Me movie franchise, I think we can call it now. You have managed, with the help of your UK-based producer, Marcus Agar, to engage marvelous Miriam Margolyes. What can you tell us about the project, and when can we expect to see it?
Well, first, I have to say a really big thank you to Marcus. Without him, this would be impossible. He introduced me to Miriam in the first place when I was actually visiting London in maybe 2016, when we were on Rain Dance, or in Cambridge, I don't remember now, in Parliament with Next to Me. We had a fantastic conversation, you know, and it was a dream come true for me, you know, because I was watching Miriam in Blackadder when I was a kid, and then she really won the hearts of another generation with the Harry Potter films, and just her TV appearances are legendary, and she's a extremely educated and warm and intelligent woman. When we talked about Serbian history, Yugoslav history, she really knew a lot. And I think I remembered that, and I kept that somewhere in my mind. And when I was writing this new film, I was thinking about this character of this grandmother who is a British woman from Manchester who fell in love with this Serbian guy from Yugoslavia and moved to Belgrade in the 60s. And then her history, her personal history, is the history of former Yugoslavia in a way. And I just wrote a biography of that character. I didn't send the scenes or anything, just her life story, Granny Vera. And I sent that to Marcus, and he said, I said, can we maybe contact Miriam, her agents, and would that be interesting for her? And he did a really marvelous job of making that happen, actually. And that's why I say, you know, we need to appreciate all the people who are creating the films, and not just the directors and actors. And then when Miriam read it, she really liked it, and we we agreed to make a film, and that's finished now, and I couldn't be more proud of everybody involved in the process. I think it will be a very special film, very different from anything I've done so far, and I'm looking forward to the moment when we can share something of that with the world. But just the whole experience of working with the actress that's on level of knowledge and understanding, masterful understanding of that craft of acting on film, as Miriam is, was a gift. I consider that really one of the nicer things that happened in my career. Just the thing that she gives you in that very first shot, after all these conversations and studies of the character and everything, it's pure magic, you know. So all those years and everything that she has done, you can see that in that very first shot, and there is very little directing to be done when you work with such an actress.
Mm-hmm. And how did you go about actually this movie? Because from what I understand, it was filmed during the Corona crisis, when people couldn't really move and you couldn't be in the UK. How was that experience in making a movie when you couldn't be actually at the location, and then putting it together, doing it from all these different sides? It must have been quite daunting on one hand, but actually with modern technology, I guess it was a little bit easier.
Yeah, well, you were helping us on the British side, so I guess you know a bit about it. You know, it was strange. You know, writing the film that's okay. I mean, you self-isolate anyway if you want to write a good film. But then when you start working with actors, I really missed that eye-to-eye communications. But it's a strange film because the film is set during the COVID pandemic, and the main character, she's a journalist, and she's trying to investigate this disappearance / murder in the circumstances of the pandemic. So that was limiting on one side, and actually also. We were free to experiment with the form on the other side, because when she's talking with somebody, she's talking via Zoom or Skype as we are now, and so we could actually rehearse and see the final shot in the rehearsal, and just do it without the lighting and without the crew and without the cameras. And it's a pure artistic experience that's maybe closer to theater than cinema, you know, because in cinema you have all these distractions, you have like 100 people and lighting in your face and cameras and everything. But in theater, it's usually your imagination, there is the director and the actors, and we are all communicate and work together and try to create something out of nothing. So it was a very liberating experience. I loved the process.
Right, and one of the questions that's just arrived, which could be linked to this in a way, thinking about locations, what mainly drives the choice of filming locations for you when you have limited resources available?
Well, for locations in Serbia, you can actually get them with limited resources or no money. So we did that short Star Wars film, which Marcus Sager was a member of the production team, and he was in Serbia, and we were filming on some really grand monuments and historical places that look unique and amazing. And I was just in New York, and Museum of Modern Arts had the exhibition about the brutalist Yugoslav architecture. And we were able to get those locations for free. So locations are usually not the problem in, like, I don't know, maybe 80% of the cases. You just need to go and see stuff and remember stuff and think of a creative way to use it in your film, but I think Serbia has brilliant locations from ancient Roman times to medieval times to modern socialist architecture. So I think there is a undiscovered treasure chest in those locations for any production, you know, to be used.
Yeah, and just taking a step back again, talking about the movie that you are have done or are doing with Miriam, and taking into account everything that we have mentioned so far about the difficulties that people can face when making movies, have you actually managed to secure all the fundings for the movie itself, or are you still chasing final funds? So just to see where you are, at what stage.
So far, only enthusiasm. So we have applied with Film Center Serbia for the funds, we will see what happens. But I don't think that there is another film with that strong of a cast and featuring Miriam Margolyes and Bane Trifunović and Ceca Bojković and Tika Stanić and all the wonderful actors from next to me, like Darko Ivić and Mina Nikolić, of course, who is our star of the project and the principal character. So you have all these arguments, and you have all the success of the previous films, and that's what I was talking about making it quantifiable. That's when you have all that on the table, it shouldn't be so easy to say no, we're not going to give you any funds. We're going to give it to our political cronies or business partners or whatever, and that's the that's why I'm not, I'm not hoping for that. I'm just waiting to see what happens and then thinking about what are we going to do next. But that's a big problem. Like when you have all the arguments on your side and still the only thing you get is awards and accolades when the film is finished. But in the post-production, the funds are given mostly to the films that you have never heard of.
So in a way, if somebody listening to this, if they want to get in touch with you, if they're willing to fund, we can freely point them in your direction. That would be great, because having seen part of what you were doing on this particular movie, but obviously following your career, I think it would definitely be worth making sure that it does see the light of day, because it is an amazing experience, and I think probably would give a boost to a lot of filmmakers in Serbia and the region, that nothing is impossible, that you can actually get in touch with people of Miriam's quality and range, and create those links and actually utilize it in a way and open Serbia as a destination, not just in terms of, yes, you can go and make movies there, but actually you can collaborate with people there and make something that can be educational, but entertaining as well and interesting. And all of that during the period when most of us couldn't do much. But talking about the sci-fi in particular, I mean, I know you are a huge fan and some of your movies actually attest to it, which is great. It is a genre that is not as represented in the Serbia cinematography very much. Do you think that things are changing actually in that area? I mean, I know there were a couple of movies from Slovenia that came out that were quite interesting, but in terms of what you can see in Serbia, and are you planning to make another sci-fi creation anytime in the future?
Well, maybe it's changing a little bit. When we were doing Shaitan's Warrior, everybody said it's completely impossible, and yet it was possible because of the digital revolution and because of the democratic opening of some of the techniques to create those special effects that happened with the digital revolution and the digitization of the process. So that was a big step in creating the possibility to do stuff, and the rest is up to us. You know, I know that people are afraid and always are thinking that, oh, but they are very expensive films. How can we do it and make it look good and so on? We just made that short Star Wars film with, I think there must have been 100 people working on it with absolutely no budget, just an enthusiasm. So it can be done. It's just a matter whether it'll be supported in any way by the people who can support it, and whether the artists will choose to tell their stories in a different way, you know, because you can be very political in sci-fi, you can be very political in horror films. I think it's a mistake just to choose one genre, which is usually happening in European cinema, and just do social dramas. You know, okay, that's important, but we can tell interesting stories. But it's always important not to be generic in that. You know, if we are making a sci-fi film, then bring something of your own history and personality or society or whatever, you know, into that. Because the most important and interesting aspect of sci-fi and high fantasy is the what we call the world building. You know, you that's what Tolkien did with Lord of the Rings, and that's what George Lucas did, and that was done Frank Herbert with the Dune. You have to create that world and set of rules in which magic is possible, for example, in Harry Potter, or the Force exists in Star Wars or whatever, you know. So that's a very interesting and creative process. And I think anybody can do that. You know, there is no limitation to imagination. So you have every resource on your disposal in terms of getting yourself educated and reading and getting books online, and then just that creative process of writing is the most important to a film. And then maybe, you know, it doesn't have to be Star Wars, but it can be a smaller scale sci-fi film. The most important thing is, and the thing that you will be remembered for and appreciated for, is that core idea and emotion that you brought to that project. And I think that that's where people can concentrate on.
Great, and we have added a link to the Breaking Point, which is available on YouTube. I think for any Star Wars fans like myself, it was just a brilliant thing to watch. But as my colleague has just put in the chat as well, you don't have to be a Star Wars fan to appreciate the story and the effort that was made, and the location at Avalo, which is just perfect for something like that. But just to see what enthusiasm and goodwill can do with nothing, in a way, because it really looks extraordinary. We're going to wrap up in a second, but before we do, I just kind of as a last question wanted to ask, what does the future hold for Stevan?
Who knows? For now, editing of Next to You, and trying to get the best film possible out of the amazing hours and hours of really, really amazing stuff that we made. So the post-production of this film and the filming of the third film in trilogy, which is set for sometimes after the pandemic or next summer, hopefully. So those are the plans that I can speak of so far.
Great, and I'm really looking forward to everything that's coming from your direction. As Marcus has just mentioned, making of featurettes are available as well. Great. Stevan, thank you so, so very much once again for agreeing to be our guest. I think we heard quite a few interesting things from you, and as ever, sort of provoking things as well to make us stop and think about what we actually observing in the world around us, and through the movies that you are portraying that really well. We wish you all the success with all the future engagements and movies that you're going to be making. And I can imagine how wonderful it is for your students as well to work with such a creative person as well. And to everyone else for joining us today, sending your questions in advance or during the chat. It was an absolute pleasure, and we hope to see you all very soon. Thank you.
Thank you. It was lovely to see you and talk with you, and I really enjoyed it.
Great. Good evening, everyone.